switch in English if you don't mind. So thanks a lot, Jérôme, for the invitation. Thanks you all for coming. I'm an economist by training, nobody's perfect, working on health issues in the south and in the north. So I worked a lot on malaria and infectious disease in the south, public policies, and also mortality inequality and the link between mortality and macroeconomic activity in the north. So I will present you today a range of papers dealing with inequality in mortality in France, the US, and Europe. And I will focus on inequality in mortality with a historical perspective at the end of this presentation. So feel free to interrupt me if you have any questions during my presentation. I don't know exactly how you work generally, but you can interrupt me. So my motivations today, I start with the fact that America has death problem in poor and rich places and across all ages mostly. The American deaths are higher than the European deaths. And this is challenging to understand for high-income countries, but also for the general relationship between inequality, income, and health, broadly speaking. So the problem does not currently exist in Europe. Okay, the question is why Europe is performing better, what France specifically is performing better than the US, and can we learn also from historical perspectives that are very scarce. Okay, we have little evidences on inequality mortality over a long time period. So the presentation will not be so technical. In general, in econometrics, we'll do more in terms of difference in difference or quasi-experimental analysis. But here I will focus mostly on the graphical demonstration. And I will present you a series of graphs related to these two questions. So income mortality gradient is of broad interest for a long time, not only in France, but also in the US. You have a lot of papers, and probably one of the most known is Angus Deaton, Nobel Prize in Economics, who has worked a lot on these issues and published a paper in 2003 in the Journal of Economic Literature, making a summary of this literature. So what are we going to do today? I will present you briefly the debate and the main mechanisms linking inequality and income inequality and mortality. Introduce next the methods and challenges that we are using in previous works to analyze inequalities in mortality. Provide some recent results from France and the US, provide a historical perspective, give you a tentative explanation, interpretation of these results, and discuss some avenues for research. So this is an old debate, okay? You have this quote from Deaton that the stories about income inequality affecting health are stronger than the evidence, but you also have a very known paper from Wilkinson and Pickett in social science and medicine that survey a broad number of papers and that argue that there is a strong evidence that income inequality affects population, health, and well-being. So the basic two arguments, in fact, are that poor people may benefit from living close to rich people because of public good provision, and high inequality areas may be doing well. And the second argument is that provision of public goods to members of a community can make it more difficult to agree on the provision of these public goods, such as health, okay, in the presence of inequalities. So why? The arguments given by Wilkinson is that not the characteristics of the individual themselves matter for their health, but the characteristics of the societies where they are living in will determine their health status. So, as a result, most egalitarian societies should be healthier and have lower mortality than inequalitarian societies. So there are a number of channels that could affect this relationship. First, income inequality may have psychosocial effects. So greater differences between individuals provide higher levels of competitions and therefore may generate more frustration, more stress, and probably higher cardiovascular disease or other disease related, other deaths related to stress and frustration. People are also more inclined to trust others who are similar to them, and therefore income inequality should decrease social trust. There is obviously a composition argument. Okay, income inequality implies that there are more poor people in absolute terms in societies who have relatively poor health, and thus the overall standard of health within a country or within an area with high inequality will be lower. The poor may also influence other people with unhealthy lifestyles, other activities that are associated with low income. This is what is advanced by Wilkinson and others papers as well. And lastly, there is a policy argument. Unequal societies are associated with underinvestment in social policies, and this may result in lower health in general. So of course, Deaton has criticized this literature and has said that in fact, this relationship is, sorry, seems that there is a problem with the okay. So Deaton has criticized this literature and said that in fact this relationship may be just spurious. Before 2000, for instance, in the US, child mortality has declined a lot, inequality has increased. But in fact, probably the reason for the decline in child mortality was mostly due to technological progress affecting mostly low-birth children. The same for the older or middle-aged population, which has been mostly affected by exogenous events such as the HIV epidemics and other causes of death that are not related, obviously, to inequalities. And Deaton observes as well that for the elderly, probably inequality increase is associated with progresses in health of the elderly, because mostly maybe you have contemporaneous policies that will affect these mechanisms. So there is a debate between Wilkinson and Deaton and also many other authors, and therefore we need to explore a bit more this relationship. So for the two past decades, there are many studies that find steepening gradients among older adults in the US, and there is a renewed recent interest in this literature. So the first one is the paper from Case and Deaton in PNAS, which was a booming paper on the white-black mortality convergence in the US, which says that the white and black are converging, and probably one cause for this convergence is the death of despair epidemics. Death of despair are the deaths that are I'm sorry for the technical problem. So death of despair are all the deaths related to suicide, pain, homicide, and also alcohol consumptions, drug overdoses, and things like that. After this paper, or basically simultaneously, you have a paper from Chetty and others that analyze life expectancy in the US with big data, and they find that higher income was associated with greater longevity, and differences in life expectancy across income groups increased in the US over the period. So high variation also across areas was found in this paper. This paper was published in the JAMA, and after this paper, there is a work from some of my co-authors, Curie and Schwant in Science, that find in fact more optimistic messages, because they suggest that in fact the effect on of inequality will be reducing among the younger people. So this is a more optimistic message, and we will see some graphs about these results. There are more recent papers from Couillard and others from the Journal of Economic Perspective in 2021 that shows that there are rising geographic disparities in the US, middle-aged mortality, so confirming the work from Chetty and others. And this seems to be mostly due to differential adoption of policies and differential performance of the areas that are studied in this paper, because in fact they don't find that in some states in the US education differences is affecting so much the mortality gradient. So the reason was mostly the way the policies are implemented. So you have many other papers from Cutler and others on these literatures, and therefore there is at the moment a huge interest for this topic in the US. There was a conference from the NBER, National Bureau of Economic Research, 2 weeks ago on this specific topic. In France, we have also a few studies. So for instance, Barbieri is also managing the human mortality database at Berkeley, finds that there are large geographical disparities in France, but with male and female convergence. You have also more studies from INED. You have a paper in the Lancet from Nave and Lou and others that shows that you have a redistributive mechanisms in France that may be also impeded by social inequalities in health. And in Europe, you have a lot of papers from Mackenbach and others in the New England Journal of Medicine or the BMJ, showing that you have declining mortality inequality in Europe, more as a result of health behaviors, probably, than policies aiming at reducing such inequalities. I would like to note as well that in France, child mortality has been increasing recently, okay, and you have a recent paper in the Lancet Regional Health Europe in 2022 that is showing this trend. So this is probably an issue, a recent issue in France. So I will comment on a few papers today. The first one will be this one, Pauvreté, Égalité, Mortalité, published in the Journal of Population Economics with my colleagues Curie and Schwant. I will not cover this one, which has been published in Demography, which is a demographic journal, but also a journal in economics, and where we analyze the link between mortality and macroeconomic conditions in France over about 30 years. So I will just give you a few graphs here just to summarize this paper. In fact, we find no consistent relationship between macroeconomic conditions and all-cause mortality in France. Jérôme knows well this kind of work because he worked on the topic a few years ago. And we find absolutely no relationship. When we make a regression of the log mortality on unemployment with a number of factors or a number of specifications, a number also of time windows, we nearly never find significant coefficients as illustrated by this graph, which means that the relationship between macroeconomic cycles and mortality are probably not procyclical in France, and also that there is a weak association in France on macroeconomic activity and health in general. So here, for instance, you observe that the trend, the effect of unemployment on mortality was probably lower before, negative effect of unemployment on mortality, and it became basically positive. This is a trend that we observe much more significantly as well in the US, but in France it's not significant, so a weak relationship. I will also try to combine two other papers from my colleague Hippolyte Dalby and Florent Bonnet from INED and Paris School of Economics, which are analyzing spatial inequality over time in France over long time periods, and that have been combining also data on income and mortality in a very long time period. I will talk about the PNIS paper that we published at the end of 2021, which is analyzing inequality in mortality between black and white American in the US in comparison with Europe, and also that has been published in a special issue of fiscal studies in 2021. So let me go back and enter directly into what we are doing in this kind of papers. So it's a very basic framework is this one. So we try to rank small areas by income. Okay, we bid them into percentiles of the population, and we calculate mortality by percentile bids. So it means that we will take, for instance, the richest counties and the poorest counties in the US, generate some mortality rates from individual mortality database or census, and make some regression analysis on the and provide some graphical illustration on the mortality convergence or the inequality convergence or divergence over time. So, for instance, if the curve is flat, it means that the level of inequality is very low. If the curve is positive, it means that you have higher mortality among the poorest areas. And if the mortality trend is increasing over time, so you have the oldest year in blue and the recent year in green, then if you have this trend, you will have increased inequality. If you have a diverging trend, you have decreased inequality. So it's possible also to have a kind of econometric framework, because here you have only one country, but you can add a number of countries in this framework and make a kind of definitive analysis as far as you have exogenous condition. I will basically present the graph here and not enter into the details of the tables, but you have the equivalent in terms of inference in the papers to see if the trends are significantly different from zero. So of course here the causal analysis that is classically done in econometrics is not the purpose, okay? We are not trying to analyze the causal determinants of mortality, but in fact, comparing different countries, we can stay close to the data with graphical approach, and we can still move towards a kind of causality analysis if we compare, for instance, countries with different, very different health systems, like France and the US. So in fact, with this kind of framework, we can answer to the question, how does, for instance, the 5% living in the US, in the richest US counties compare to the 5% living in the richest French areas? And you can do the same for the poorest areas in France or the US or in other countries in Europe. So we analyze how the mortality differences between these groups change over time. And we can adjust, of course, or not, for changes in county rankings or department rankings in France. And we can adjust for population size over time, as previous papers that have been published, for instance, in the International Journal of Epidemiology. So one advantage of that is that, in general, mortality is quite difficult to get and connect to income, for instance. But if you do this analysis at a level that is aggregated, you can connect income to mortality at the county level or department level or any other small area level that you want to analyze. Also, this enables you to, unlike when you are analyzing mortality among subgroups, this enables you to get population groups that are large enough to provide precise mortality estimates. And as we will disaggregate mortality by age, it will be important to have precise mortality estimates as well by ages in age groups where mortality can be low, and therefore this is an advantage to have this geographical approach. We can also account for compositional changes that I mentioned previously, for instance selective migration, because we can rebin the ranking over time, and therefore get populations that are basically the same over time, taking into account this selective migration. And of course, the advantage is that we can replicate this approach to a large number of countries. One of the caveats of this approach is that, unfortunately, we will not be able to say much about inequality within places, so inequality within departments, inequality within counties will not be the purpose here. We will mostly focus on inequality within countries with this disaggregation. So why are we focusing on mortality rates by age group and not life expectancy? Of course, we can do both, and some of the papers include both. But life expectancy is a summary measure that collapses all of the age-specific mortality rates observed in a given year into a single number. And it provides information about how a cohort of newborns can expect to live only under the assumption that the age-specific mortality rates observed in that given year remain constant into the future. So life expectancy at birth not only mask potential differences in age-specific trends, but the measure is also dominated by the changes in old-age mortality, for instance, in high-income countries, but it could be low-age mortality in developing countries or low-income countries. Okay? So instead, here, we will focus on mortality by age, and my co-authors have shown recently that, in fact, using individual data or aggregating the ranking that we use is basically similar. They are doing this work in California, and they try to compare the life expectancy by median income percentile by BIN. And when they aggregate from the census, they find basically the same trend at the county level compared to individual observation from the census. So it means that we can use this approach at a rather macro level without too many risks. So now the results of this approach. Here in this graph, I compare, using the method I showed you before, I will compare the US and France from the 90s to 2010. Recently, we have increased and updated this graph to 2018. It means that we can account for the opioid epidemics in the US. So what we can say first from this very simple graph is that there is a flatter gradient, much flatter gradient in France than in the US. So France is in red and the US is in blue. Okay, so if you observe, for instance, the infant mortality, what you can observe is that the bold curve for the US is much below the normal curve for the US, and therefore infant mortality has declined a lot from the 90s to 2010. Okay, but the gradient in the US is much more positive. Remember that we have the poorest areas on the right and the richest on the left. We have poverty percentiles here. And the poorest areas in the US have a much higher mortality rate than France. And also, if you take the two curves, 90 and 2010 in the 90 in France and 2010 in the US, you observe that, in fact, they are not so far. So it means that there is nearly 30 years delay for the US poor in this graph, comparing these two countries. Okay, in terms of infant mortality, this is basically the message. One optimistic message that I already mentioned from the science paper here is that still infant mortality inequality is declining in the US. So the gradient becomes flatter. So it means that you probably have the effect of some policies at play in the US that may improve infant mortality or mortality at young age. You observe basically the same kind of trend until age 50. For the middle age group, you observe that mortality inequality is not declining in the US, and for some age group, it is even increasing. This is, of course, for men, but we have a similar figure for women. There is one pattern that is also interesting from these figures, that you have when the different curves are crossing. It may say that, in fact, you have more equality in France at the expense of the richest. So it means that probably having more equality in France, maybe at the expense of the richest, which will have higher mortality than the equivalent richest in the US. Okay? I will come back to measurement issue and other stories after. So one pattern also that you can say from this graph is that there is a high inequality at all age, which is probably showing the effect of selection, but also mostly explaining as well the fact that you have socioeconomic determinants of health that are more important at older ages than at younger ages. If you look at women, you observe, of course, a difference between men and women mortality in terms of levels, but you observe basically the same pattern. France is flatter, the US is much more unequal than France. Poverty ranking. Of course, the poverty measurement is different in France and the US. In France, it is mostly related. In Europe as well, it is 60% below the median income of the country, and in the US it is basically an absolute threshold that is used. So what we can do here is try to compare the US ranking using the French definition of poverty, so comparing the absolute threshold with the relative definition of poverty. And when we do that, in fact, we find still a very high correlation of 97, showing a very straight line, and therefore saying that, in fact, measurement issue is not so important for poverty here. Another issue is that you have much more inequality in the US than in France. So the poorest region in the US are probably much more much poorer than in France. So here, what we can do to take this into account is just to take the poverty, instead of taking the poverty rate, we just take the value of poverty in absolute terms here. And we observe, in fact, that the range of inequality in income or poverty is much lower in France, but the pattern, the basic pattern remain the same. The gradients are not affected by using either the rate of poverty or poverty definition directly. We can also use different measures of socioeconomic characteristics. So we have plotted here France and the US for the poverty rate. So this is basically the same as you observed before, but for general mortality. And we did that for education, for median income, and for life expectancy. So here, you see that, in fact, the patterns are basically also the same when you use when you are using different measures. After that, what we are doing is that you can also simulate. So you can also make counterfactual exercises to understand what will be the effect of, for instance, applying a specific mortality rate by cause to the US mortality and check what will be the effect on the general mortality in the US. So for instance, if the US had the French accident rate of France in 2010, we will gain, we will close the gap between France and the US by about 30-40%. So it means that probably France is performing much better in terms of road accidents than the US. Okay? This is true for males and for females. For the different categories that may be affected by this specific rate. For the deaths of despairs that have been very emphasized in the US, in fact, we don't find any kind of gain, which may be a kind of indice that finally deaths of despairs matters, but probably not as much because we don't have this kind of deaths of despair epidemic in France, and still the US rates are relatively stable when we apply the French rate. For cancer, this is the contrary. So for instance, France seems to perform much worse than the US here, because when you apply the cancer specific rate to the calculation of general mortality in the US, you observe that in fact the green line here will increase for the male population. So it means that probably the US have been performing much better than France in terms of cancer management. I would just like to come back very shortly to an update of this. Okay, so here I added the 2018 line for France and the US, and what you observe here is that for certain categories of ages in the US, mortality inequality is relatively stable, but the last year for the US is sometimes higher, for instance, for the 2049 category, the 2012 mortality rate for the US is increasing. And this is reflected by this graph by ages, where you observe that for certain categories of ages, mortality increases a lot in the US, general mortality, probably due to the opioid epidemics. So going back now to the last paper that I wanted to present today is a paper from PNAS where we do the same exercise but comparing, adding much more European countries and comparing also the black and white in the US so that we compare the European the European population. We don't have ethnic statistics, unfortunately, in France to do that by ethnicity, but we compare the US white with the European trends, and also we compare the black and white in the US. So here what you can say is that first the gap between the white and the black in the US is huge, okay? You observe in 90 a huge gap in terms of mortality. The inequality seems to be relatively similar for infant mortality, but still declining over time in the US white and black population. But what you also observe is that there is a huge convergence of the black population to the white population. And in black here, you have the European trend. So here, what you can say as well is that the US white population has a higher mortality rate than the European population, but also that the gradient seems to be much higher, mostly for the black, but also for the US for the US white. You find this kind of result from most of age groups, and therefore you can have the same conclusions in terms of mortality convergence for the black and white. And if you get if you compare in terms of life expectancy, in fact, you will get that life expectancy gap fell by about 50% and mortality inequality decreased, although the process has stalled after 2012. So I just note here, when we have more European countries, that for instance Portugal has made a lot of progress from the 90s to 2018. And this is a question: why some European countries are converging so fast, whereas the US are not. So if you take, for instance, the age 20 to 64, which is the one affected by the opioid epidemics in the US, you observe much higher gradients, but still the same kind of pattern that I presented for infant mortality. In terms of causes, what are the contributions to life expectancy in the US? In fact, the gap is closing between the white and the black because of probably fetal infancy that is declining a lot among the black population. HIV is also an important factor compared to the white, but cardiovascular disease doesn't seem to explain so much difference between black and white convergence because it is globally the same in terms of gains from these specific causes. Cancer may also be an explanation for that, and the death of despair are not to be avoided here. They impact mostly the white population, and this is consistent with the Deaton paper and from Bernays. So basically, here we plot the life expectancy at birth for the European countries, and if the life expectancy was not plateauing, in fact, we should have convergence towards 2035 between the black and the white. And because we are plateauing since 2012, therefore, we don't really know what will happen. But still, the European life expectancy is much higher than the white population in the US. The dashed line also simulates the US mortality with the death of despair of the 90s. So you see that there is this difference between white and black in terms of progress when you simulate. So death of despair may matter, but probably not as much as was argued before. Lastly, I move to the historical analysis. So we do the same again, and we analyze inequalities over time, but over a long time period. And of course, there have been some approaches that have done this with analyzing spatial inequalities over a long time period by my colleague Bonnet and Dalby. And they identify a period of from 1881 to 1980 when inequalities rapidly shrank across departments. But since 1980, spatial inequality seems to increase in France. And also, you seem to have a kind of urban advantage during the 20th century, whereas it was an urban disadvantage before. So what we do here is that we use a unique database that merges and extends the database that were done by my colleague Bonnie, and enables to get consistent data over time, over a very long time period, 1 century of data. So we have the statistics available from the archives of INSEE, and we also have fiscal income for the period 1920 to 2020. And these data are from income tax statistics available from the French Ministry of Economy. And therefore, we can generate the same kind of trends over time. So we replicate Curie and others over 1 century in France, but the use of chronological age here may be problematic. Why? Because life expectancy has increased a lot over the period. But it is relevant to make this analysis and replicate Curie and Schwann, because probably comparing France in 1920 to France in 2020 is like comparing two different countries as well, considering the changes that we observe over time in France during this time period. So we will use a kind of standardization of the ages in order to take into account this life expectancy increase. So I show you again the different graph that we produced for by age group over time for the chronological ages. And here, what we observe, in fact, is that we have a kind of reversal of the gradient. The gradient was negative at the start of the period, which means that poorest areas had lower mortality and richest areas had higher mortality. So it means that probably here we have an effect also of the density of population with respect to infectious disease. And we observe a decline of this gradient and a reversal of this gradient going back to a positive gradient as we found in the more recent studies, and a flattening also of the gradient at the end of the period. Depending on the categories of age, of course, the gradient is much higher at the end of the period than at the start. The gradient is much higher for high age groups than for younger age groups. So if I zoom, you observe this pattern for men and women as well, not only for the general population or for men or women separately. And you have basically the same pattern all the time. So what we do, in fact, is that we plot the same, but we make a simple regression analysis with some confidence intervals, and we just plot the gradient here over time, and we observe what I just said, that in fact there is a reversal of the gradient around the 70s. Okay, it is quite surprising to find a reversal of the gradient so recently in France, because in fact we were expecting when we did this work that this reversal was happening mostly at the start of the 19th century or at the end of the 18th century, but in fact it seems to be much more recent than what we expected. So now we use the standardization method, and in fact we have a large literature on that is using some milestones instead of using chronological ages. You define ages at which men and women reach certain thresholds in terms of risk of dying during the year, and therefore you define milestones, and the milestone is defined as the age, the first age at which men and women reach a certain percent of mortality risk. So therefore you account for the life expectancy increase, and this is much better than using remaining life expectancy because it will integrate much more mortality improvement. Okay, so in this case, what you can say is that, for instance, men in the 30s faced a death rate of 2.5 per thousand before age 50, while today the same death rate is reached at age 65. The gap between men and women remains quite constant over time. So then you recalculate your income guidance to see if you find similar robust results, and you generate the same kind of graph. But instead of taking the chronological ages, you take the milestones, and therefore you select the corresponding age at the national level, and then you compute the gradient using death rates observed at this age. So for instance, for different milestones, you have the evolution over time and by over age, and you observe that for a death rate of 0.5, the age is increasing quite a lot. Of course, this approach doesn't enable you to include infant mortality because the age will be zero. So doing that and replotting the gradient again, we still find a reversal of the gradient for different mortality milestones. So accounting for the life expectancy increase, you get positive and significant coefficient at the end of the period, so a positive gradient, and negative coefficient at the start of the period, and the switch is about during the 60s again, so the results are not driven by the increase in life expectancy over time. Income measure as well, we try to get whether or not this is due to income in value or income in rate, and if we take income in value instead of ranking by rate of income, we still find the same reversal of the gradient over time. So conclusions and avenue for research, I'm nearly done. The link between inequalities and mortalities are not systematic. When you compare US and France or Europe, but also within countries, social policy may matter. We know that the French healthcare system is one of the most redistributive with low out-of-pocket expenditure. And this may explain the difference in gradient between France and the US. So it's not a causal result, but still, the evidence is relatively clear when comparing these two countries, even with simple graph. The lack of any mortality inequality at younger ages in France can also be seen as a result of both universal availability of healthcare, but also technology, because we know that some technologies were introduced over the period. For instance, exogenous surfactants impacted a lot infant mortality over the period. The remaining inequalities at all ages are probably due to the socio-economic determinants of health, such as education, employment, and income support that are really difficult to reduce at all ages. In the US, mortality inequality decline as well for the younger age group, so it means that also this is a positive message in terms of the effect of public policies on health inequalities, and there are many studies at the micro level using individual data and quasi-experimental analysis that are showing that health insurance expansion in the US are improving infant and child mortalities and leading to better long-run outcomes. Social policies can also explain increased inequalities paradoxically. For instance, if you take the fight against smoking in the US, the cohort that have entered all age over the past two decades experienced strong decrease in smoking rates and therefore probably cancer rates that were particularly dramatic among persons of high socioeconomic status. So this may be a selection effect, why you observe more inequality at the end of the age distribution. In France, the historical results show that the reversal of the gradient was surprisingly very recent, that probably there is a urban penalty that is still at play after the Second World War. And this is a question today, because with the COVID and more infectious disease, we should probably understand what will be the effect in terms of urban penalty for the distribution of mortality in France. And also, something that I didn't mention, but the COVID crisis, because in this last study we go to 2020, and we observe level of the gradient that brings us about 10 years before. So it means that inequalities are probably increasing a lot also with the COVID crisis. In terms of question and agenda, I have many questions here. How much politics account for death in France? So for instance, Ditton in a recent paper analyzed the great divide, taking into account the votes for Republicans versus Democrats in the US, and analyzing how this is correlated with mortality. So in France, we could do the same. What will be the effect of policy making on health promotion? We know that policy making by elites are not always health promoting. So is it the case in France? What is the role of the welfare state over time through the introduction of social security in France for in a more causal analysis? So this is a question I have. How would excess mortality from COVID affect the gradient? How the income mortality gradient is affected by ethnicity in France? We don't know. We don't have any kind of ethnic statistics in France. We can just do it by origin. And what is the role of the labor market and wages in this literature? Are living standards in some cities affecting also this gradient? How much the allocation of health in rural areas, this is a debate today, could also affect the gradient? And lastly, analyze the effect of the COVID crisis on inequality in mortality, but also by causes. So I don't know the answers of all these questions, and there are avenues for research. Another exploration that we are doing is that we are exploring the same in the South. So I have a doctoral student that has done the same in Chile and Brazil, and I am replicating this approach with 80 low-income countries. But in low-income countries, we can only, or mostly in most African countries, for instance, we can only use the child mortality rate. So here, these graphs are done with DHS from infant mortality rate. It may be useful to analyze low-income countries, and this is my last slide, because, in fact, it is not clear if it is inequality, as Ditton said, that is affecting inequality in income, that is affecting per se mortality, but maybe it could be just a proxy for poverty. So I think this is there is a huge, urgent need to understand, not only at the micro level, but also at the macro level, or with small area analysis, to explore this question of poverty versus inequality, and how they drive mortality, whether or not it's just a composition effect, because it could be just due to a composition effect. If you have more poverty in a country, therefore, obviously, you will have more income inequality related mortality. Even if you eradicate poverty, it will take time to observe the decline in inequality in mortality. So thanks for your attention. I am done and available for questions. I hope I have not been too long.